Amazing Grace.
Once was lost, but now am found. A
this is the day that the Lord has made. We can rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome as we come together to worship at St. John Lutheran Church here in Mapleton, Minnesota. We enjoy the outdoors and we celebrate God's garden. That's the theme of worship. I hope you notice that throughout the songs and the scriptures and the litanies and the prayers. As we come together to enjoy the creation God has given us to enjoy and to take care of, and to enjoy the many blessings God has for us to receive and to share. Welcome to so many that we haven't seen. We're still not quite together in a normal way quite yet, but it's great to connect and be together in this way so that we can worship together. And I noticed in the months that we haven't been able to meet in person, you haven't lost your Lutheran identity. You've all found the back of the church. For those who are tuning in, the shade is all in the back. And so it's a beautiful day, but the sun is working quite well, and the shade is a lot more comfortable. So it's good to see so many of you here. And welcome to all who are tuning into this broadcast. Hopefully the word got out that this wasn't live at 9:30 Sunday morning, but it will be on later for people to enjoy online. I hope that by joining us, we're a blessing for you, and you can be a blessing for others. Several announcements. I see a few kids there. We have some crafts over here, even during the worship or after the worship, if you want to go over and pick some up and enjoy. And feel free to color and create and take pictures of it and send it back in so that we can share that with others in the slides that precede worship when we broadcast. Also, there's a lot of this and that sale. You'll notice on the back side of the announcement sheet, because of many cancellations of events, we have some fundraising that was going to happen, couldn't happen in its normal way. So there are some items here. There are some inside too. We hope that you will wear a mask when you walk inside. And there are also, these things will be available during the weekday mornings when the office is open as well. Two council announcements. One is that there was an approval from now on. The monthly newsletter that comes from St. John will be called the St. John Story. I find it helpful to have a name to refer to the newsletter, so roll that around on your tongue for a while. The story, if you hear about talking about the story, that's the newsletter. Probably a more important announcement is that at the Thursday meeting, the council recommended and approved to begin to make plans for to resume in-person worship in September. Plans are still being made, and as you know, in this day, as the news happens, plans tend to have to be changed. But the front part of the church will continue to be sectioned off for the worship leaders so that we can continue to broadcast worship online. That's kind of the first priority. And then starting in September, once we get the plans figured out, people will be allowed to come in, sit physically distant. Unfortunately, that group of the worshiping community will have to refrain from singing and even speaking together. That's the recommendations. There won't be communion or passing the peace, but there will be a chance to be here in worship in person. So we hope that you will stay home if you're not feeling well, or if you've been exposed to someone who has the virus, but otherwise we'll begin to worship together. And as always, until then, be safe, be kind, be filled with God's peace, and be overflowing with God's love. I think now it's time to worship.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We come before our God as workers in the field.
Ready to sow the seed and harvest the crop.
We come before our God as branches grafted to Jesus, the true vine.
Ready to be watered, fertilized, and pruned.
We come before our God, the great landowner.
May we bear fruit, sweet and plentiful.
We come before our God, who has done marvelous things for us.
May we praise him now with a new song.
The sun goes down.
A man planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a pit for a wine press, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants.
The Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden. The Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to till it and keep it.
When the season came, he sent a slave to the tenants to collect from them his share of the produce of the vineyard. But they seized him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And so it was with many others.
My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile field. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes.
He still had one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, they will respect my son. But those tenants said to one another, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. So they seized him, killed him, and threw him out of the vineyard.
Jesus said, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit.
The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest.
Please pray with me. In the beginning, Lord, you planted a garden, and it was good. Into it you placed Adam to till and harvest and produce. Still, we labor in your field.
Help us in our planting, Lord.
That the seed of your good word may abound in our lives. Help us to spread that seed with enthusiasm and faithfulness.
Help us in our gardening, Lord.
That we may lovingly care for your beautiful world, and that others may be so encouraged by our good works that you would be glorified.
Help us in our harvesting, Lord.
That more workers may join us as we await the great harvest of souls.
Amen.
Thank you. Good morning, boys and girls. For the children's sermon today, I'm going to have you just stay where you are, but raise your hand if you would usually. Way to go. Hi, Kevin. Not you, Scott. Age, not attitude. No, I'm kidding. Very good. Welcome as we celebrate today God's garden. How many of you have a garden at home? All people may answer this. Very good. We call gardens different things. Sometimes we'll call it like a patch, like a tomato patch. My neighbor Denny raised this beautiful tomato in his tomato patch. He also raised this beautiful zucchini, which Pat's having for lunch. Very good. We have sweet corn. Sweet corn, we'll sometimes say, grows in a field, right? Right, very good. We also have just regular fields. We have garden flowers. We use a lot of names for where we are able to harvest God's great abundance on his behalf. Today in our story that Pastor's going to read from the pulpit, we're going to hear about a vineyard. And in a vineyard, they grow grapes. And Judy went out yesterday to Barb Lake's vineyard. And they're super, super tiny right now. We don't always grow great grapes in Minnesota for another couple weeks. They'll get bigger. I'll leave these up here and you can come and look at them. Look at them later. They're super tiny right now. Do you think it's easier to pick grapes or is it easier to pick tomatoes? Probably tomatoes. And you know, if you work in a vineyard, sometimes they call you a really fun name. It's called a vintnologist because there's vines and that's where the grapes grow. The story today is a parable. A parable is something you'll hear about a lot. A parable is a story that has a lesson. And the lesson today is about a man who hires workers. First, he goes out early in the morning and says, I need workers to come help me with my grape picking, and I will pay you one denarii. Then later in the day, after lunchish, he goes out and he does that again, and he gets more guys to come and help him pick these grapes. Then at the end of the day, he does it again. He sends them to the vineyard, and they pick. The day is done, and the harvest is over, and the men all come in and talk with the man. And he says, here's your denarii, here's your denarii. They were all paid the same. Even the people who came super early in the morning, they got the same pay as the people that came at the end of the day. Does that sound fair? Probably not. The guys that came early in the morning were there all day. They gave up their entire day to work in that harvest. So the man says to them, I told you I would give you the denarii, I would give you this pay. The pay is the same for everyone. The parable is about that, is about being there the whole day and getting the same. It's not really about the amount. It's really talking about God's love and being in his eternal garden. In other words, God loves us the same whenever we arrive, whenever we're there to feel his love, whether it's early in the morning or late in the day, it's all the same. So even though the story is about a bunch of people in a vineyard picking grapes, it's really about the fact that God accepts us and loves us no matter where we are, okay? If you would, take a moment to pray with me. Bow your heads for a moment. Thank you. Dear God, we, the stewards of your land, come humbly before you in with a grateful heart, knowing that we are in an abundance of your garden. Amen. I'll leave this up here if you want to come and see these really teeny grapes. They're very cool. You can even eat them if you want.
Thank you. from Genesis chapter 2, verses 4 through 9, and verse 15. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth and no herb of the field had yet sprung up. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground. But a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to till it and keep it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsively with me Psalm 95, verses 1 through 7. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise.
For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
In his hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also.
The sea is his, for he made it, and the dry land, which his hands have formed.
Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand.
Oh, that today we would listen to his voice.
The second reading this morning is from Revelation 22, verses 1 through 5. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, through the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is a tree of life, with its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month, and the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. Nothing accursed will be found there anymore, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. And there will be no more night. They need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Run into his arms.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, from the 20th chapter. Jesus said to his disciples, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. Then he went out again about noon, and about 3 o'clock he did the same. And about 5 o'clock he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idly all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers, give them their pay, beginning with the last, then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last." This is the gospel of our Lord. So grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, who gives undeserved grace, and from Jesus, his Son, our Savior, who tells surprising stories. Amen. Truth is, as far as stories go, this is more than surprising. It's just not right. At least not according to worldly wisdom. But the real truth, God's truth, is that this story is good news, the best news possible. We just have to learn to understand it and accept it. You know, it seems that part of our nature is to have an inner sense of fairness and order. So when someone butts in line in front of you while you've been waiting patiently, that's irritating, and you know it's not right. When someone eats healthy and exercises regularly and then dies too early in life, that's heartbreaking, and you know that's not right. When the world as we know it gets shut down by a pandemic, and we're isolated from others and prevented from so many of the things we like to do, that's heartbreaking, and you know it's not right. And certainly when someone works hard for a full day and gets paid the same as the short shift workers, that's not good business, and it's not right. But there's a lot about this parable that Jesus tells that rubs us the wrong way, because it just isn't fair. But as Kristen pointed out, this isn't about fairness. This is about God's grace. Actually, other than the unusual wage distribution, this parable describes a very typical occurrence in Jesus' day. In just a few weeks, like here in Palestine, the grapes will be ripe. And a few weeks after that, the heavy rains will come, potentially destructive rains, because whatever part of the harvest isn't gathered in that relatively short window of time, it'll all be washed away and lost. I'm sure with today's equipment and today's technology, most harvests are complete and successful, but in biblical days, every vineyard relied on manpower. And so when it was harvest time, many workers were needed to pick all those ripe grapes, even if they could work for just part of the day. There are many references in the scriptures to slaves and servants. They were considered second-class citizens, but they were citizens and members of the household where they worked. And so as family, they never had to worry about not being fed. But these day laborers that were getting hired in this parable, they were the lowest class of workers, and life for them was always on the edge. If they didn't get hired, if they didn't receive the usual day's wage, then probably they weren't going to be able to feed their family that day. So they weren't just lazily hanging around the corner of town. No, at the beginning of each day, they would show up at the marketplace, and they'd be carrying their tools of the trade with them, hoping someone would hire them. And they would wait all day if that's what they needed to do to get hired. So this story sounded very understandable and typical to Jesus' listener, except that part about how the wages were paid. Now that got everyone's attention. I think that's what catches our attention too. Probably because in Jesus' day and in ours, everyone has a tendency to identify with the first workers hired. Since we know this parable is Jesus' way of teaching us something about the kingdom of God, we are quick to reason, well, we've been in the church a long time. We must be the full day laborers. We've been given our time and our talents to serve God's purpose. We've borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. Yet the last minute add-ons get the same reward. The problem with that kind of thinking is that fare is based on an assumption. That assumption is that we are worth more than others, or more worthy than others. That thinking seems to be almost universal. Researchers found that 80% of students believe that they were above average. 90% of Americans say they're generous. And nearly every one of us, 97%, claim to be good citizens. No wonder we think we deserve more than others. We believe that we're better than others. It's not so much that the first workers, us, are greedy. It's just that they, or us, want justice. At least we want our brand of justice. You see, the first hired workers were actually fine with the wage that they received, because that's what they agreed upon at the beginning of the day. But when those who worked fewer hours received that same wage, that's when the grumbling began. Clearly, that sense of unfairness comes from a self-centered perspective. I got what I earned and expected and deserved, the first shift worker might say, but I don't see why those guys should get the same thing. And they felt justified in having that indignant attitude. But they aren't the only ones in Scripture with that attitude. Think about the older brother from the prodigal son story. He was upset about all the attention and excitement given to the younger brother upon his arrival home. But think about it, that attention, that excitement had absolutely no effect on what the brother, big brother, had before or after the homecoming party. Think of the Old Testament prophet Jonah. He didn't want to go to Nineveh, but once he was finally there, he wanted to see the judgment that God had threatened. He wanted to see that actually carried out. But when God showed grace and mercy to the people of Nineveh, Jonah was upset. "See, I knew you would handle it that way," Jonah complained to God. Jonah, the older brother, the first hired workers, all were upset with God, but not about how they were treated. Instead, they were upset about how generously God was treating someone else. And unfortunately, we too fall into that same attitude. When we think that our arrangement with God is all right, but we aren't sure if it's all right for our neighbor to get the same benefits. One commentator I read put it this way: it is simply a fact that people regularly understand and appreciate God's amazing gift of grace applied to themselves, but fear and resent it seeing it applied to others. Of course, maybe we should stop and consider that we should identify with the last hired workers. We are the last ones to enter God's kingdom of human race, because the first, of course, was Abraham, and with him all the children of Israel that first received that promise. They were followed by the first disciples in the New Testament and early church, and they were followed by our ancestors and forebears and the pioneers and those from the old country. Then here we come. Maybe we are the ones unfairly receiving God's good grace. Are we getting too much in exchange for too little work? But that's the reward that's promised everyone. And I think that's what this story leads us to ask ourselves, whether we're part of the first hired workers or one of the last chosen, where is it that we were asked to work? What is it we're asked to do? The answer, live in God's garden. Till it and keep it. That's what was told to the first human being in the Garden of Eden. Enjoy it, till it, and keep it. And it'll be that way until he comes again in the revelation that we hear the garden around the throne of God with the river of life flowing through it. There, nothing bad will be found in it anymore. And everyone in there won't even need light because the light of God will shine upon them and they will reign forever. And all that is possible because in between was the Garden of Golgotha, where we, like Mary, encounter the one whom she assumed was the gardener. And he was a gardener of sorts, but in truth, it was Jesus, her Savior and yours, the resurrected one, the one who won new life for us all and gives it to us as grace upon grace. Because that's what the Lord grows in his garden, grace, which he gives to us so that we can join in the work of gardening, planting, tilling, harvesting, loving, caring, serving, with the hope and plan that all people will be able to join us in the garden and also receive grace upon grace. See, that's the only wage, that's the only reward God offers us from his garden, the gift of life. And there's no such thing as half life or double life, just life. Abundant life in these days, eternal life in the time to come. Blessed life, forgiven life, peace-filled life, joyous life, new life, God's life. Given to you, early arriver or late comer, freely given to all who live in the garden of grace. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I see the sky.
and the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Generous God, you make the last first and the first last. Where this truth challenges the church, equip it for its work of service. Bless all who follow Christ. Strengthen all who suffer for Christ. Lord, in your mercy, sun and rain, night and day, field and forest, human life, animal life, nothing in creation is outside of your concern, mighty God. Lord, in your mercy, tend to it all, and give us a spirit of generosity toward all that you have made. Lord, in your mercy, where we find envy and create enemies, you provide enough for all. Bring peace to places of conflict and violence. Inspire leaders with creativity and wisdom. Bless the work of negotiators, peacekeepers, development workers. Lord, in your mercy, reveal yourself to all in need as you are gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, ready to relent from punishing. Accompany judges and lawyers, victims of crime and those serving sentences. Give fruitful labor and a livelihood to those seeking work. Lord, in your mercy, in the midst of this battle, we pray for all who are afflicted and affected by COVID-19. Bless the efforts of leaders and organizations, small businesses and farmers, educators and students, the unemployed and the underemployed, first responders and medical workers, and most of all, protect the vulnerable. Supply us generously with your grace for our life together. Lord, in your mercy. Even beyond our expectations, you choose to give generously. Grant life, health, and courage to all who are in need. Today, we're especially mindful of your presence with Jeff and Orville, Jake and Ashlyn, and any others whom we name before you now in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. We praise you for the generations that have declared your power to us. Give us faithfulness to follow them, living for Christ until you call us to join them in the joyful song around his throne. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. God graciously gives us the gift of grace. As we are made in his image, it's up to us to reflect on how we can also be generous and give grace and love to others. We'll pause on that, reflect on that a little bit. There are baskets, two baskets, and then I think there'll be a basket at the, as you are leaving or coming around now to the vehicles. Reflect, please, on how you can continue to be gracious reflections of God's goodness. When we do come to the offertory, my mistake, those of you who are diehard musicians will know that's talus canon, not talisman canon. And we won't be singing it as a round, we'll just sing that as an offertory response. God, you welcomed us here as we gathered together this morning after a long absence from one another in many ways. You welcomed us to worship you. We're here not because we're perfect people, but but because you are an awesome God and worthy of our worship. But thank you for making us worthy to stand before you, to worship you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, as we close this meeting, we pray that our worship has been acceptable before you today. Thank you for the wonderful time that we have shared. Now may we continue in your word, use it for the glory of your holy name, and share it for the well-being of others. In Jesus' name we believe and we pray. Amen. So God's beauty is found in the world around us. As you go this week, chase beauty. When you find it, share it with those around you. Wherever you find yourself in the coming days, be a bearer of light, hope, and peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So now go in peace to serve our Master Gardener.
Thanks be to God.
We are singing.